You may be surprised, but the most popular algorithm for finding motifs in DNA sequences, roll dice and take chances to find such motifs. They're called randomized algorithms. How they work? We now learned how to construct profile given motifs. But can we construct motifs given profile? We can, because given an arbitrary profile and a set of sequences DNA, we can construct the set of motifs of profile and DNA by simply finding profile most probable chimeras in each sequence from DNA. And therefore, we can further iterate this process by finding profile of motifs, motifs of profiles, profile of motifs, until our motif keep improving. So this is the key idea of the algorithm called randomized motif search. We simply iterate and see whether the score of motif continues to improve and stop when it doesn't improve anymore. The only question about this algorithm is how in the world it can find anything useful. Think about this. We started from completely random motifs. If they are completely random, then presumably, and if they are taken from random sequences, then presumably expected probability of every element in profile matrix is 1/4. There is absolutely no information in such a motif. How possibly it can lead us to the correct motif in the sequence? Let's just keep our fingers crossed and see how this approach works on an example. Here's my example. These are very short DNA strands, and I implanted 4-1 motif in each strand. They're shown in blue, so A, C, G, T is implanted in every sequence with a single mutation. So how randomized motif search will proceed? First, it will randomly select motifs shown in bold here. And as you see, of course, it missed most of the motifs. They are randomly selected. Afterwards, it will form motifs matrix, shown here on this slide. And afterwards, it will construct profile of motifs. Using profile of motifs, it will calculate probability of every chimeras in the set of strands, shown here, and simply select the most probable chimeras in every strand. The results are in this matrix, and I should probably start iterating. But if you look carefully at this matrix, I don't have to iterate. It already found all blue inserted motifs right there. It almost sounds like a magic trick, because we started from something completely random, and in a single iteration, found our implanted motifs. What happened? So let's try to think about this. When we form chimeras randomly, it results in a uniform expected profile, as we discussed before. But strings in DNA are not random, because we have inserted implanted patterns in our DNA. And therefore, this implanted motif result in a biased profile. It's not completely random profile. Where does the statistical bias point to? If it points to direction of the implanted motif, then there is no miracle that we start from something random, which is not really random, and applying iterative procedure arrive to a hidden pattern. So let's see how it actually works. So I return back to the case that we considered before, and you saw that when we randomly selected motifs, in the first sequence, we missed the motif, the correct, the blue one. In the second, we also missed it. In the third, we missed it. In the fourth, we missed it. By the fifth one, simply by pure chance, we actually found it. It's not a big deal. It just there is always a probability that we simply by chance select one of the correctly of the implanted motifs. But it results in a bias profile. If you look at the profile that resulted from this implantation, then you see that the largest element in this profile actually corresponds to ACGNT of our implanted pattern ACGT. Therefore, even a single correctly found chimer in the set of DNA strings create a bias in the profile, and this bias leads us to the correct sequence. Of course, it doesn't always happen. It depends on how we have chosen initial set of randomly selected chimers in the sequence. But if we try this algorithm thousand or million times, there is a good chance that eventually one of these attempts will bring us to the correct motif, even if this procedure sounds completely ridiculous. We now move to the next topic, which is how do bacteria hibernate to try to apply our motifs finding algorithms to real biological problems. To figure out how our algorithms work on real biological data, we will start by analyzing tuberculosis. Tuberculosis is a deadly disease that killed a quarter of population in Europe in the 19th century. Unfortunately, humanity is not done yet with tuberculosis, since tuberculosis strains that resist to all antibiotics are now emerging. And tuberculosis is caused by Mycobacterium tuberculosis, also called MTB. An interesting thing about MTB is that it can persist for decades in human, and one third of the world population is affected by MTB. Of course, it usually doesn't lead to tuberculosis, but in some cases, bacteria switches from its latent states to active states, and then it's when tuberculosis disease begins. The question that we will be asking is how MTB switches from latent to active states, and how does it survive during latency? MTB has an ability to form dormant spores where metabolism is shut down, and in such sporulated form, it can survive in very tough conditions, for example, in conditions of food shortage or oxygen shortage. An oxygen shortage called hypoxia is associated with the latent forms of tuberculosis. So how can we figure out what makes MTB switch into latent states and return back into the active states? What biologists done, they performed a DNA array experiment and identified roughly 25 genes that are activated in the hypoxic condition. So when bacteria is deprived from oxygen, this gene dramatically change the expression. And our goal today is to discover what regulatory motif controls these genes when they are activated or repressed. We now have quite an arsenal of algorithms for finding motifs. Let's try them. But the first problem we have is we have no clue what size of motif to try. Should we try k equal 8 or k equal 20? Let's try all of them using median strength problem and randomized motif search. And you will see that for different k, we're getting quite different results. It is not clear which one to choose. For median strength, we actually will have difficulties going beyond k equal 12, because remember, it is an exponential algorithm whose running time grows as 4 to the power k. But for randomized motif search, we can search for very long motif, and for k equal 20, we actually find this rather long motif. And you can see that there are similarities between 12 mer found by median strength, 12 mer found by randomized motif search, and 20 mer found by randomized motif search. Which one is correct? To answer this question, we need to introduce the notion of the motif entropy. An entropy of motif is defined in the following way. First, we construct the profile matrix. Every column of profile matrix corresponds to a bias, four-sided dice, or in other words, to a probability distribution, P1, P2, Pn. Sum of Pi's equal to 1, of course. An entropy is simply defined as minus Pi multiplied by logarithm Pi and sum up over all probabilities. For example, we can compute the entropy of the first column, and it will be 1.147. We can compare it with the minimal possible entropy, which corresponds to the motif, extremely conserved motif, where all symbols in the column are the same, and with maximal entropy, where every symbol in the column is equally likely. So the entropy of a motif is defined as the sum of the entropies of its column. And now the moment of truth. Let's see how the algorithm that we develop find out whether the motifs that we find are close to the biological one. Here is the motif logger of the dormancy survival regulator site. And motif logger is constructed in such a way that the total length of four nucleotides in the motif logger correspond to 2 minus entropy. So for completely conserved column like nucleotide G in this motif, we will have height 2. It is, they show the most conserved elements of the motif. The relative sizes of four nucleotide in each position correspond to frequencies of these nucleotides in the column. So now this is an example of motif logger. Now let's see how it works for tuberculosis example. You can see that our randomized motif search actually captured a good portion of motif. But you can also see that we missed in some places. And we need to work harder and to figure out what to do to develop better regulatory motif finding algorithms. We move next to another randomized algorithm called Gibbs sampling.